Welcome all to the public meeting of full council Thursday 16th of November. Apologies, we have one from Councillor Bartlett. Are there any further apologies? None. Any leave of absence requests?
Yes, 15th to the 20th of December.
Any further?
Yeah. 13th to the 30th of November.
25th of December.
Okay.
No.
That was all good. Okay, so any further?
2024.
Okay, so I move that the leave of absences be approved. Seconder. Thank you, Cody. All those in favour?
Aye.
Thank you. Declarations of conflict of interest. None noted. Matters lying on the table. There are no matters lying on the table. Special announcements. I have one. Which I'm going to get up right now. So one of the pleasures I have as being the mayor is I get to mentor every year a rangata, which is from the mayor's task force for jobs. And it is my pleasure to hand over the certificate to Alia, so if she can come forward, please. Now, the two-year program is a program that selects a rangatahi from myself. It was an application process earlier in my term, so at the end of last year. And I get to mentor Alia. I think she probably mentors me more than I mentor her. We've discussed quite a few things about her aspirations to work with youth moving forward. So from there, her family, her background, to even the attractiveness of a man on a male, which I still disagree with, but anyway. So I really appreciate Alia. I think you've probably done more for me than I've actually done for you, so really appreciate getting to know you, and I definitely hope that we get in contact for you in the future. So there you go.
Thank you, fellow. Thanks, everyone. Thanks, Mum. Cool. Thanks, guys. Kia ora, everyone. My name is Alia. Just that's my story thing. Ko Taki Timu Te Mauna, ko Te Ara Apewa Te Moana. Ko Arahura Taki Timu Te Waka, ko Kaitahu Rātou, ka te māmoe, ko Waitahana Iwi. Ko Te Rau Aroha, te marae, ko Alia Tuku Iwoa. Kia ora, my name is Alia. I'm just going to say a quick few words about the Tuia Kaupapa, but I'd like to start off by saying thank you to Glyn for sponsoring me this year, and also Topaz, who is in here, for organising and coming along to all of our coffee day. It's been really cool getting to know you both this year and hearing a little bit about the mahi that goes on behind the scenes. Tuia, in a short description, is a kaupapa where rangatahi from all over the motu get together 5 times a year, and we go to wānanga and different marae around New Zealand. We learnt about the significant landmarks, the importance of kōrero and whakapapa, and how to give back to our whānau and communities. Tuia for me has been a life-changing experience. I've met friends for life and made connections all around the motu and have learned much about myself and have gained confidence and just grown as a person. I just want to say thank you again for giving me the opportunity.
Public forum, 5 speakers, 3 minutes each. Pierre.
Kia ora koutou katoa. Globally, October was the 5th month in a row to break temperature records and by a large margin. But even if this is causing, amongst other disasters, raging fires in Australia, we will focus today on slightly more positive news coming from the global justice system. Climate change is the largest crime ever committed and potentially the last one. We are all responsible, but some of us more than others. And the justice system is slowly starting to play its part. The United Nations recently released Global Climate Litigation Report shows that governments and private sector entities are being increasingly challenged and held to account. As of December 31st, 2022, their non-exhaustive and strictly defined database contains 2,180 such cases. As more of us are being directly affected by climate events, we can expect the number of climate litigations to increase substantially in the coming years. These cases cover a wide range of situations. In Montana, a judge ruled in favor of 16 young plaintiffs that the state's law violated their right to a clean and healthful environment. In Europe, six young Portuguese people are suing 32 European countries for their climate inaction. Six US universities are being sued by their students for their fossil fuel investments. And nearly 2 dozen states and cities in the US have sued large fossil fuel companies seeking compensation for damages. The Dutch Supreme Court forced the government to increase its planned emission reductions. And in Holland again, a court ruled that the petrol company Shell needs to reduce its emissions by 45% by 2030. In Australia, victims of bushfires have successfully sued the governments, and here in New Zealand, councils, Waka Kotahi, and the central government have all already been sued in relation to climate change. These lawsuits have all so far been civil lawsuits, but there is an international push toward the crime of ecocide to the Rome Statute. This would enable the world to sue climate criminals at the International Criminal Court in Den Haag alongside war criminals. When fully implemented, people who are most responsible for the collapse of our climate system, beyond being publicly shamed for their actions, will also face actual jail time. Don't be climate criminals. Quack will present you today with a master plan, looking to expand the pollution by 30% in the next 10 years, while asking you to pay for it when the council's finances are already failing. This is a textbook definition of a climate crime. We need to reduce the emissions of our largest polluter, not increase them. We are urging you to refuse Quack's master plan and to instead plan for a reduction in passenger numbers. This could be achieved in different manners, but we believe that a passenger tax that would both reduce demand and create income for the council is the best way forward. Bali just introduced such a tax. There is no real reason we couldn't do the same. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Ich bin Sie ist Kat. Kat Gilman. Okay. Three, James.
Members and councillors, my name is James Stokes and I'm the Managing Director of Pinocchi Air, small family running line with Fife to Milford Sound, Mount Cook and Stewart Island. We currently tripleise the Sun #1 Queensland activity. Our business has been operating on Queensland Airport for over 28 years, most of that time with a presence in the airport terminal. We're proud members of the airport community and have grown with the airport over the decades. I was involved with the consultation process around the master plan that's been presented and was asked by QAC to attend focus groups, which I did. I found the engagement to be of an exceptional standard with the needs of and expectations of operators and community listened to and incorporated where possible. I worked with Ben Sarri through the process and he's been unequivocally supportive of general aviation's importance in the Waka Tipu. The community has spoken. We do not want expanded noise boundaries over the airport in the next decade. QAC has listened to this and has designed a plan which will allow the airport to take advantage of new aviation technologies to grow sustainably and responsibly while remaining efficient, all without breaching this limitation and while returning strong dividends to the ratepayers. From the point of view of a fixed-wing general aviation operator, the current airport layout is inefficient and has some operational risks due to the close proximity of fixed-wing and helicopter operations. There are no other examples we've found worldwide where fixed-wing and helicopters, of course, integrate like they do at ZQN and in a one-way-in, one-way-out manner. The master plan will bring Queenstown in line with international operating standards by separating helicopter arrival and departures from runway procedures, requiring less wasted fuel and cutting out plenty of noise by reducing everybody's holding times. Glenorchy Air has begun an extensive fleet upgrade program in order to become the most sustainable aviation operator at ZQN. We are currently working with the industry to bring sustainable fuels into New Zealand when possible. And with the recent addition of our new and first for New Zealand Dacia Kodiak, 75% of our seats, which sit in the most modern light aircraft fleet in New Zealand, are capable of running on this fuel, and that fuel will save an 80% in the emissions we're producing. Now, the biggest challenge we have is space. Our larger multi-million dollar Cessna Caravan aircraft, currently set outside because our aging and not so temporary hangar is not big enough and can't grow where it stands. We have to walk our passengers hundreds of metres out of the terminal to a back gate and onto the apron, walking around private jets. And to avoid having staff spilling out of our terminal space, we now have admin and staff space in Portacom's airside. In order to meet our sustainability goals and to remain the best rated activity in Queenstown, we need a world-class sustainably powered hangar facility on a world-class airport with the infrastructure in place to provide future technological advances. It's not possible with what we have now, but the master plan will provide for this. I urge the Council to endorse the master plan and allow QAC to get on with providing a world-class, efficient and sustainable facility our community can be really proud of. Thanks.
Thank you.
Circle back. I see Kathy, have you caught breath?
Not quite, but enough.
Okay.
Can I pass these around for actually start? Please excuse my attire and my lateness. I was trying to keep down our carbon footprint.
Good.
Okay. Sure, everyone, as you probably know by now, I'm Kath Gilmore of We Love Off Tibbing. You will have all yesterday received an email from me with a submission made by airline industry representatives to QAC's master draft plan in the response from QAC's CEO. And in front of you now, just in case you didn't have time to read it, are copies of the same outlining the perspective of all four airlines that fly into ZQN on the $350 million development program you are being asked to endorse today. Many of the questions they ask are questions we Love Okatibu has been asking already. In your QAC governance roles, these are questions you should also be asking and making sure you get meaningful answers, not pro-growth spin, because the consequences for all of us are serious. Not just in over-tourism and its multiple negative impacts, but also an unsustainable debt at a time that you're already closing in on your debt ceilings and having leaky building, leaky pipes and other liabilities. It was this submission that finally saw Glenn Starry drop his pretense that the active listening claimed by QAC would extend beyond 2032. As his response to the airline industry quite clearly states, and I quote, "The current noise boundaries are not a fixed geographic or permanent legal constraint." When asked at a Franklin consultation meeting some months ago what happens when they're reached, he said he didn't know as he would be retired by then. But I do note that his comment that, quote, "committing to limitless growth and turbocharged tourism is considered an outdated approach and is not supported by stakeholders in this region," end quote. And yet extrapolating QAC's supposedly modest 3.2% annual growth beyond the plan's foreshortened horizon, we find ourselves at exactly the same number we rejected back in 2018, around the same as Christchurch International Airport quotes in its Central Otago Regional Plan airport proposal, on which note, I understand you've still not commissioned a SWOT analysis of the proposed airport. It's hard to understand why not, because tariffs will offer shorter flights from Australia, fewer turnarounds due to wind shear, lower carbon emissions, and a much better safety profile than ZQN. But you know that some of the reasons that then Air New Zealand CEO, Christopher Luxon, pushed for a new Central Otago Regional Airport in the face of QAC's 2018 plans. So I urge you, please do not greenlight the entire $350 million master plan. Expenditure should be stepped, and Council should have a gatekeeping role on expenditure, perhaps through approval of such steps through the LTP. CIL is due to decide on going ahead on resource consent next year. Any growth-oriented development work should not happen until at least after this. If CIL pushes the go button, then we will know whether it's going ahead within 3 or 4 years. As the airline industry submission says, airlines should not be asked to fund such capex when faced with a potentially end-of-life airport, and nor should our community. I am heartened to see QAC's comment agreeing with We at Love Wakatibu's stance that, quotes, "long-term provision of aviation infrastructure in New Zealand should be a wider conversation led by central government and taking into account all views of affected communities. It should not be led by a single district or airport company." and Council should today not endorse QAC's master plan to fund growth way beyond the parameters of that conversation. Any questions?
Thank you, no.
Can I just put one question for the agenda when it's discussed, and that is, can we please have it explained why you're being asked to endorse it as opposed to reject, accept or agree, which is the usual terminology? It just sounds a whole lot stronger than I think you really want to be checking your name down.
Thank you. Sharon.
Tēnā koutou katoa, Mayor Lewis and elected members, thank you for the opportunity to speak today. I'm Sharon Fifield, Chief Executive of the Queenstown Business Chamber of Commerce, and I'm speaking regarding the Queenstown Airport Draft Master Plan. The Queenstown Business Chamber works on behalf of a membership of over 600 local businesses. For over 30 years, the Queenstown Business Chamber has served local businesses with the mission and purpose of fostering a thriving business environment within the district. While looking back, Queenstown Airport has been serving the local community for close to 90 years. We are the independent voice for the Queenstown business community, and further to our written submission, I wish to express our support of the airport draft master plan and the consultation that has gone alongside this. Business is not separate from community. We are part of the community. It is important for business to be doing well for our community to thrive. Queenstown Airport is vital strategic infrastructure for our district, playing an important role in the economic well-being of our region, as well as our resilience in the case of emergency. We're fortunate to be a major shareholder in the airport and to derive economic benefit not only in terms of reciprocal and convenient access for visitors, colleagues, goods and freight, but also in the return of dividends to the community. The master planning process has been undertaken with community front of mind. We cannot ignore the economic impact the airport has for our community, job creation, GDP contribution and ease of doing business. Queenstown Business Chamber commends the airport's alignment with the district's approved destination management plan and the spatial plan and the commitment to operate within existing noise boundaries. The business community of Queenstown is focused on leading the way and embracing all forms of innovation that can ensure we continue to grow in a sustainable way. I believe Queenstown Airport is absolutely committed to sustainable practice, having recently supported their bid to be one of the first airports in New Zealand to host low emission and zero emissions aircraft. We should be proud to have such a vital asset work together with the community in their planning process to align with their broader community aspirations. This is not an input or control we would have with alternative airports serving our region. On behalf of Queenstown Business, I'd like to thank Queenstown Airport Corporation for their engagement in the development of the Master Plan and wish to reiterate our support. Thank you.
Last but not least, Grant.
Thank you. For those of you who don't know me, I'm Grant Hensman of the local Walker Booth Quality Control Group. I'm here to ask you and to recommend that you endorse our latest strategy, which we have prepared. The first strategy was done by Council. There was a Council document some 15 odd years ago, and I would remind you that this group has come into existence at the instigation of Council, who were very forward thinking some 14 odd years ago to tackle this problem. And in that time, we have managed to leverage up the funds that were supplied, not just by Council, but also by some others, up to $26 million we have invested so far in this issue. The strategy sets out the way forward. The strategy is really quite simple, which is get rid of coning trees. It's really not much more complicated than that. It's short strategy. Yeah, it distills down very, very quickly. The reason is quite simple. I would use the analogy of a leaking boat. Why would you bail that boat out for 100 years when you can fix the leak? Because sooner or later you'll get tired of bailing and you'll sink. And we face the same issue. So we need to tackle those coning trees. And also, it has the side benefit of addressing the growing virus that I'm sure we're all aware of and have seen in other parts of the country. And that's it in a nutshell.
Thank you, Grant.
Thank you.
Okay. Confirmation of agenda. I move that the agenda be confirmed without addition or alteration. Do I have a seconder? Thank you, Lisa. All those in favour?
Aye.
Motion carried. Confirmation of minutes of meeting. Any amendments? Thank you, councillors. I move that the minutes of the public part of the ordinary meeting of the Queenstown Lakes District Council held on the 19th of October 2023 be confirmed as a true and correct record. Do I have a seconder? Thank you, Barry. All those in favour?
Aye.
Motion carried. Item 1, page 15 of your council papers. Endorsement of the Queenstown Airport Corporation Draft Master Plan 2023. So Megan, I'll allow an invite from the CE of QAC and board member Simon Flood. I can bring them to the table.
Thank you. I wonder if we could set aside standing orders to...
I'll talk with governance. Apparently I don't need to.
Okay.
So that's brilliant.
Thank you.
So I can invite the CE of Queenstown Airport Corporation. Sorry, that was my 3 minutes. Grant was so efficient. And Simon, and I and Andrew as well, the finance officer. I'll just bring them forward so if councillors have questions regarding technical matters of the master plan, it can be answered. It's not all for me. Right, you, Megan?
Thank you. I'm happy for the paper to be taken as read. And actually, I think the best thing we can possibly do is enable you, councillor, to ask any questions you have of the QAC. Thank you for coming.
Councillors, questions?
Okay. I can get the ball rolling through the chair, if I may. Thank you for the report and the work done. Big job. It's great to see the community involvement. I've got two questions for the chair. Thank you. I've had some dialogue with some of the GA operators and I just thought I'd ask a couple of questions, see if I can get them answered here. They've made contact to say that they have concerns around safety at the site, i.e. wake turbulence issues, and there's not enough land on the north side to cater for the existing helicopter operators and the current number of machines. Any comment around that at all?
Thank you. Through you, Mayor. The decision to move helicopters to the north and fixed wing to the south was off the back of significant consultation with Airways as the air traffic controller for the airspace, engagement with the Civil Aviation Authority and many, many other users of the airport. As James Stokes mentioned at the in public forum a short while ago, the current layout of the airfield with helicopters and fixed wing adjacent to each other is not considered best practice. It goes as far as saying it's a long way from that, and that's a historical artifact. So based on the engagement, the consultation we did, we were strongly encouraged to separate the two, and indeed in Airways submission to the master plan they state around the Northern Aviation Precinct, that Airways has considered the air traffic management implications of this and supports the proposal. The separation of helicopter operations away from fixed-wing aircraft will improve safety with respect to operations on the aerodrome. One of the primary reasons for that is that 70 to 80% of helicopter departures from the airport are to the north. And so by being located on the northern side, they do not need to cross the active runway. That materially improves the safety profile of the airport. And currently, not only do they have to navigate around the terminal and where all the aircraft hard stands are, but they then have to cross the active runway to go where they want to go. So we're very confident that that makes sense. What we will be doing is we did an initial concept of operations study which informed what I've just described. but in the event that the master plan is endorsed and subsequently approved, we'll be engaging with a much deeper aeronautical study, which is exactly how the airspace and the land operations will operate to ensure that they're as safe as possible. To date, CAA, as the regulator, have had good engagement and have supported the, again in their submission, the current approach that's been proposed. So I think the issue around the physical space and whether all of the helicopters can fit there, we believe they can, but we will be working with all of the helicopter operators to get into detail to ensure that we can enable safe operations and that they can operate at the scale that they currently do safely from the north, and we believe that is possible.
And my final question through the chair, thank you. They've also brought up any proposed development should be based on a full aeronautical review, which would then determine the best use of the airport land. Their view is that the current approach is based on land utilisation rather than an airspace perspective. Any comment around that?
Yeah, I think if I may, just I won't repeat my previous answer, yeah, but I probably preempted that a wee bit. We believe that what's proposed here is the safest aeronautical response for the reasons I was describing. But we will continue to work with all operators, particularly the general aviation operators, to make sure it's going to work safely and efficiently for them into the future. And it will, of course, be fully subject to civil aviation authority approval.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you,
Fred. Thank you. Just a couple of things. One, Kath asked a question from public forum just around what, I guess, what endorsement means. So first question is, what does endorsement mean to the board? And
I think that's a question for us, because actually we are the ones that stipulated that we would be endorsing the plan after much debate.
And it's I'm just asking a question of Glenn Sowry, because obviously the proposal in front of us is to endorse, and I'm interested in how the board interprets it and what the board would do if we didn't endorse it.
I think it's unfair for the chief executive to speak on behalf.
Yeah, that's
of the
fair
board.
Enough. Sorry, I can introduce that to Mr. Blunt.
Yeah. Again, it's a board decision for the, and to answer the question. Answer the question. It was the council at the time that decided to use the term endorse.
Does that mean that we don't have an understanding of what we're deciding today?
Well, we do, because we stipulated it in the statement of expectation, and endorsement was the process that the council, the majority of council, decided was an appropriate process before the final approval of the QAC board.
So what does it mean, was my question.
That's a long time ago.
We had that discussion as council. Quite a detailed discussion. So basically endorsement means to publicly give support to a position. So that's what we're doing.
That's right. So if we don't endorse it, it doesn't really matter, because the board could just go ahead with it anyway?
Well, I don't think it doesn't matter. Otherwise the council wouldn't have asked to do that. So
could the board go ahead with the master plan if we didn't endorse it?
The company has the right to approve it. It's the company's plan.
Thank you. That's the first question. Second question is around, I guess, the codependency of the different parts of the master plan. My understanding was that there were constraints based on the terminal size, and that we couldn't supersede 2019 numbers if the terminal didn't grow. That was something that was passed on to councillors several times. And my understanding is also that the taxiway is required to increase the number of landings because of, you know, the amount of aircraft circling and so on. So question around the codependence of those two parts of the master plan in terms of, if we open up the taxiway, that would enable some growth, but only if the terminal grows and vice versa, or not?
An airport system is the sum of its parts. You've got multiple aspects to it which limit or enable activity. You've got check-in, you've got the bag makeup unit, how big that is, how many bags it can control, or handle? How many passengers per hour aviation security can facilitate the process? How many people customs, MPI, can handle on arrival? How many aircraft stands there are that an aircraft can be there at the same time?
Yeah.
And on it goes.
Yeah.
So they're all interlinked, obviously.
Yeah.
And any one of those can be an impediment or an enabler. So when it comes to the taxiway, which you've asked about, the taxiway's primary objective is currently we are the only airport of our scale in the country that has a single runway. From a reliability and a resilience perspective, that presents a risk. By having a parallel taxiway, it means that we will be able to facilitate the operation of general aviation fixed wing operators onto the main runway, much more so than we can do today, which will limit their need to operate on the crosswind taxiway. That's a significant safety and operational benefit. And then in conjunction with that, it means that there will be, we believe, considerably less airborne and ground-based holds. And with that reduction and or improvement in on-time performance and significantly reduced fuel burn, lower emissions by having a more efficient operation.
So, final question. Given that there are these interdependencies, and there are financial interdependencies, presumably too, because if we need to pay down debt to do that, we have to grow. This is one complete package of works, and it's set at $350 million. I'm just curious about the Companies Act requirement to seek special requisition from the shareholders if a piece of expenditure exceeds half of the value of the assets. Has that been looked into? Because I see this as a package of interdependent pieces, and we talk about staging as our protection, but actually it's one piece of work that's costing $350 million, and I think the value of the assets was 500 and something in the annual report. So just a query, yeah. So just a query around whether that part of the Companies Act has been considered.
Look, Nikki, if you could send us that, I'd be very happy to look at it. I think the whole process that we have gone through has been one of consultation, including with our shareholders.
Yep.
And we have collaborated with our shareholders in arriving at a master plan which is different today than the first draft that you received. And the reason that it is different is because we have worked with you, we have worked with the members of the public, and it's been gratifying that the community has actually really taken an interest in what we are doing. We received 237 submissions. Yep. This is an asset that the community, whether they love it or they feel otherwise about it, take an interest in it and recognise that its success is important to the district, to the businesses, to the people that live here. So I haven't seen, and I know the Companies Act reasonably well, I haven't seen the clause that you're referring to, but I think people would be hard pushed to demonstrate that we have not taken the interests or opinions of our shareholders, as well as other stakeholders, into consideration in drafting this master plan. As for how much money we are spending, the people who will ultimately determine how much money we are allowed to spend are the banks. And banks are not known for their overwhelming generosity in the face of data to the contrary. So while management will do their very best, and you've seen some of the external independent experts that have come in and reviewed the master plan, the board has stressed and commissioned independent, external, independent. Ultimately, where the money will come from, because we are not in a position and we will not be asking our shareholders for a contribution, is we will be financing this by going to the market. And they
will run their eyes, their rulers, their calculators over our plans, and they will make a determination as to whether or not this stacks up financially. But I can assure you, from our perspective, the work we have done and the reports that you have seen, Nikki, that not only can we afford to do this, but while we are doing a significant capital program, we can also afford to maintain the dividend, which is so important to this community.
Thank you.
Thank you, Chair. I was just wondering whether, given where we are, you could have the opportunity to talk about the growth and what your 3.2 growth projections are now in light of some of the commentary that we've heard today and of recent, that growth of 3.2 is modest. I'd like to have the opportunity for you to speak to that in particular, because growth is quite a tricky one to guess and to figure out in light of some of the commentary of late. Would you be able to speak to that for us?
I think the whole growth discussion is clearly an incredibly sensitive debate with the community, and we're very alive to that. And that's what underpinned our commitment in the 10-year strategic plan to operate within the noise boundaries out to 2032. The growth, that represents around 30% growth over out until 2032. We experienced a strong recovery, as council is aware, and I've also observed the beneficiary of through last year's record dividend, back to essentially pre-COVID levels at about 2.35 million passengers in total. That's a combination of arriving and departing, which was very just shy of the 2019 numbers pre-COVID. This year we believe we're going to have flat, as in virtually no growth year over year. And that's principally because the domestic network over the next 2 to 3 years, we've had very clear guidance from Air New Zealand that with their fleet challenges, that capacity is going to be significantly constrained. And Queenstown experiences like the result of that, like everyone else. So I think it's reasonable to assume that there will be very limited growth over the next 2 years here at Queenstown. Beyond that, it will be interesting to see what happens. There are different views. I note the Barnes submission was handed out. Councillors are aware that we disclosed that and shared that submission from Barnes and our response to it to you directly a couple of weeks ago. And the view of Barnes, quite simply, is that we need to open the aperture and accept as much traffic as the airlines want to send our way. That is their view of the world. We have a counter view, and we reflect the views of our community in terms of what we're proposing here with the master plan. So it is a balancing act, but growth, I think, to answer your question, we think it's going to be very flat for the next couple of years at least, and beyond that we had assumed 3% per annum growth out to 2032. And we see nothing on the horizon in our engagement with airlines that would suggest that is incorrect or is not a sound assumption.
Thanks,
Kia ora tātou. Thank you for coming today. And thank you also for, I just want to acknowledge the care and professionalism that you've shown to both us and our community. So I've spoken already with some of the board members and the CEO about this at previous meetings. Obviously, the space that you work in is incredibly complex, and the fact that you've kind of, you've found yourself between a rock and a hard place, essentially, and you've countered that with Barnes and the community well. One of the biggest challenges that I've had is from the strategic plan, starting with the key assumptions that were made in the strategic plan, And some discussions that I've had this week have been around scenario-based preference modelling, which can describe the influence of disruptive scenarios on projects. And in the strategic plan, we obviously have a number of key assumptions. There's four in particular that I've struggled with. There'll be no major event that impacts the world economy and demand for air travel. Two, the demand planned for the next 10 years will not be impacted by disturbances in supply chain. Three, macroeconomic environment will remain stable for the next 10 years. And four, a new airport will not be established in the next 10 years. So these key assumptions have kind of created the foundation for everything that's followed. And back when these assumptions were put to us, I proposed that we had some scenario modelling. So really, with regards to where we're at now, I understand that the $350 million envelope is not to be spent right now. I hope that the community understands that. I'm not sure that they do. But this envelope is obviously over a period of time, and I understand that there's stage gates throughout that process. So I appreciate that, and we've had your verbal assurance of that. That visibility can be seen through the SOI. I guess essentially for me, I'm struggling with the foundations that our key assumptions are made on, given the debt, the incurrence of debt that we're facing, and the propositions of climate impact as well on the airport itself. So rather than climate mitigation, climate impact, and the fact that that wasn't one of the key assumptions. So if there is a question. If this goes ahead today and is endorsed by a majority, I guess my question is can we start to see the key assumptions being linked to scenario mapping for example, year two, year five, year eight, so that we can, and our community can understand what disruption looks like in terms of the risk that is, the financial risk that we're addressing.
Sure.
And I guess, why haven't we seen it? That's also another question.
Okay, let's start with the first one. When I joined the board in December 2019, and we did 2.3 million passengers that year, circa.
Just over.
Yeah, and it had been a period of extraordinary growth. Within 3 months, we had no plans. Yeah, but what we thought about as a board, and airports without airplanes are quite scary places. Yeah, because there are no passengers either. And we looked at it. And we said, we have no visibility on what is going to happen with COVID. We have no visibility with what is going to happen to our borders. But what we do know and we do believe is that as a race, the human race is extraordinarily resilient in the face of disruptive events or technologies. And you don't have to look very far, Esther, at the moment to see the world that we are living in is very disrupted. But what you will see, I can almost guarantee you, is that within sort of 2, 3, 5 years, that we will be getting on with business as a world. And what we saw with COVID was within 12 months, we were getting on with business. We took some really tough decisions. We basically cut our workforce in half, which is an extraordinarily painful thing to do for them, for us, and for the community. And under Glenn's leadership, we have been rebuilding that workforce. And we have been rebuilding the airport community. James, could talk to you about what happened to his business. But the fact is, we stayed the course. We continued to invest in our business and in our people. And we have come out, and just this year, we have written a very big check for our shareholders. And that basically came on the back of a board taking a long-term view, seeking expert advice, having trusted management in place such that we could put plans together which we thought would do what we needed to do. And so look, what I don't know what the future holds.
Of course.
And if there's anyone in here that does, they can come and sit here and take my seat. You know, but what I do know is that you have a board, you have an excellent management team, and we take this incredibly seriously, not only to collaborate with the community, but also to think about how we spend every dollar that we spend.
I'd just like to say I haven't doubted that in any of my
You asked me for scenarios, which, I tell you what, when my wife is Singaporean, yeah? My dad died at the beginning of the COVID year, yeah? And I got on a plane from New Zealand and I went to Singapore. And in Singapore, they were basically in lockdown, and New Zealand people were still on the beach having a good time. And within 2 weeks after I got back, New Zealand was talking about shutdown and shutting down its borders. I guess all I'm saying to you is that life can change very, very quickly. And what gets you through is having good people who understand what they're doing, and our management do, our board do, our advisors do, and we will get you there. But can I give you guarantees? I can give you scenarios, which we have run, but I can't give you guarantees.
So, my question is about scenarios. I mean, like Kuwait did a really good example of it.
Kuwait
airport.
Mm-hmm.
I just think that exactly what, just using all of your language, is exactly why we should have scenario planning, because we don't know, and things can turn around exactly like that. So if it happens that if our investment is $270 million in year four, and then something happens from these scenarios that I read out, key assumptions. It's just around that.
I think the only thing I can, will we do scenario analysis? Yes, and we've actually provided you with copies of the PwC scenario analysis on the business.
Yeah.
Yeah? But I can tell you, and I've been an investor, in Kuwait, and things there change very, very quickly. And you know, the things that we have down here about no major event to disrupt are wrong. We have to plan on a basis, and we recognise that.
It's about looking at what those scenarios are.
But can I just leave you with one thought?
Yeah.
Is that the airport has been in operation for 85 years, yeah? And I hope that it will continue to be in operation for another 85 years. It is a very, very long-term undertaking. And the investment that we are making in this business is to ensure that it is sustainable financially, economically, and environmentally for the long term. What you were talking about are things that happen in the short term, and all I can say to you is that I know from what I have seen in my life that this investment is worthwhile on the basis of the numbers and the thoughts that we've put together. And I commend it to you.
Thank you.
I have to make some comments. Look, I mean, I go back to when the QAC previously attempted to do some master planning in Queenstown and where we've come to since then. I mean, that was, if you like, a bit of a landmark moment and probably the moment at which our relationship or the social license became in question, if you like, when we started talking 5 and 7 million passenger movements into this airport. But look, from that time, there's been a pretty clear set of goalposts set, and whether you've agreed with those goalposts or not, the current goalposts that we have are the NOI's boundaries. And I've been involved in lots of discussions around whether they're right or wrong, but yet to be involved in one where they've moved and they still remain the goalposts that we're working towards. And with that in mind,
if they are the goalposts we're working towards, this is a reasonable response to the spatial planning of the airport with those goalposts as the goalposts. I take the point about financial risk, and you know, I think there are things that we can do to improve that. I'm open to those, and you know, that may be discussed further here. But equally, I accept that you know, $350 million isn't necessarily all spent at once, and it's not all dependent on each other. And you know, that you plan to renovate your house, you do your bathroom, you build a deck, whatever. You know, there's bits and pieces that contribute to the sum of the parts. And you don't build the deck if you spend too much on the bathroom. They're the sort of high level comments I want to make. As I said, I'm really open to suggestions as to how we keep an eye on the financial risk and oversight of that, and I'll be open to it.
Thank you. Any further questions, councillors, before we move to discussion? And I just want to thank yourself, Simon, and the CE and Andrew coming forward, and I'll ask you to step down from the table as we move to discussion. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Councillors, you've heard questions. We've got a motion, a recommended motion before us. Do I have a mover? Thank you, Barry. Do I have a seconder? Thank you, Lyle. Open up discussion. Nikki?
Just at this point, I'd like to propose an amendment to the motion that's just been put. This was circulated to councillors and staff ahead of time. What I'd like to propose is that we direct the staff to prepare a report for the Audit, Finance and Risk Committee meeting on Tuesday, 12 December 2023, requesting consideration of the financial risk associated with QAC's master plan and any recommendations to council around managing that risk, noting that the report should include all revenue assumptions. I don't know yet if I have the seconder.
Did you want a point of clarification of that in addition to the endorsement of the
last? I'll speak to that. Okay.
So yes. This is number three, so is it point three?
So this would be point three, so this is an amendment.
So it's an additional.
So adding it in. Yep. So for clarity for councillors, this isn't stopping it being endorsed. Councillors will have the ability to endorse it with this amendment sitting there. So this is an addition. So it doesn't slow anything down. All I'm suggesting that we do is we use the processes that we already have in place through our Audit, Finance and Risk Committee. If there's any doubt around that, I can have a look at the terms of reference. Sorry, my computer's tricky. So the terms of reference of the AFRC include the establishment and maintenance of controls to safeguard the council's financial and non-financial assets, of which the airport is obviously one. Its activity areas under its terms of reference include the financial performance of CCOs and also climate risk. So it sits within the Audit, Finance and Risk Committee's terms of reference, and it is obviously one of the processes that we have in place to help protect us, and we have three expert independent members on that committee to help us with those decisions and recommendations. So that's what I'm suggesting. The reason I'm suggesting it is because this is a really complex space, and we've talked about that. I mean, one of the board members, Simon, spoke to that. We don't know what's coming next, and we're living in really disruptive times in terms of weather patterns affecting airlines, in terms of climate disclosure risks, in terms of the financial context. Like, we don't know what's coming, and personally, I would feel a lot more comfortable if we went through our standard process and just had the AFRC take a look at this. It's with a view not to stopping anything if it's approved. It's with a view to putting some controls in the long-term plan. I spent a bit of time looking at Auckland Council's long-term plan, and it sets out quite clearly the controls that it expects to have over expenditure. One of the things that one of the things within the long-term plan, Auckland's long-term plan, was the mention of major transactions under the Companies Act. So under section 129 of the Companies Act, a company must not enter a major transaction unless the transaction is approved by special resolution or contingent on approval by special resolution. And there are A, B and C there, and I won't read them out, but basically if there's an investment or if they're going to incur a liability that is more than half of the value of the company's assets before the transaction, then this is triggered. So it's just one of the things that we could discuss via the Audit, Finance and Risk Committee, and we could talk about putting other controls within the long-term plan to safeguard our balance sheet and our shareholding, purely to protect the ratepayers, because this is what we're supposed to do, this is our job. And I, just as a general comment, I do feel as though there is a culture of it being good manners to just trust, the board and pass it on, and that does get passed on, and eventually you end up with all of that risk management sitting with potentially one person, and I think that's unfair and I think it's unsound. I think we're employed to do a job, and that is to govern, and part of that is to manage risk. And so that's all I'd like us to do, is use our existing processes to manage risk on behalf of the ratepayers. Thanks.
Any further discussion?
I guess I'm happy to make comment and second it. I think, I just wanted to speak, I think the report on the consultation is really well balanced and makes a concerted effort to publish all views to show the organisation is very self-aware and prepared to move with the community's best intentions. And I also just want to share my gratitude to Glenn and his leadership for his open-mindedness, sensitivity and accessible lines of communication. I feel really lucky that we do have such a part to play in this, and that we have quality people moving with the best intentions. So my support for this amendment is just to ensure that we're prudent in doing our part, and to give comfort to the community in the sincerity we have in our roles. And like I say, it's not to go against anything that we're doing, it's just to add another level of oversight in an appropriate manner that I see fit. So, thanks.
Thank you. Right, so this is just an amendment to the motion. It's number 3. So this is what we're voting on, just adding this amendment.
Can we just get it on the screen now?
I can read it out.
I expanded AFRC short refinancing for 2023.
We can work that one out. So this is number 3. It's before you now. So all those in favour? Oh,
I support the endorsement of the master plan. Just want to be clear here, what Nikki was talking about was as part of the long-term plan process, not what we're signing off on here. It goes to Finance and Risk Committee, so we're not actually putting in places or suggesting controls at this stage. It's just giving the option for the Finance and Risk Committee to maybe make some recommendations.
We have to do a little bit of have some understanding of what Nikki has included in terms of the 10-year plans. Auckland is a very different council to ours. It has 7 CCOs, but nevertheless, Nikki's raised it, something we would have to look at and probably take some advice on. And I'm not sure that. Discussion in of itself is one for the Audit and Risk Committee, but maybe one for, well, will be one for this council.
We're talking about the Board of Risk Committee having the ability to look at it. Because the way that I interpret that is that on the 12th of December,
all you're doing is asking staff to ask the Audit Finance and Risk Committee to look at something. That's what the report. That's what the resolution says.
Prepare a report. for the audit, finance and risk
requesting consideration of financial.
So I'm presuming that council would provide sufficient information for the audit, finance and risk committee to consider and make some recommendations. They can't do anything based on no information, so I am expecting soon, and I'm expecting it to be in PX. But I've also asked that the report should include all revenue assumptions.
So that's not what I read there.
What do you read?
I read that you're asking us to ask the Audit, Finance and Risk Committee to review something. I'm happy that the Audit, Finance and Risk Committee on the 12th of December can consider a matter. But when I looked at a strict reading of that,
yep,
it said our request was to consider the financial risk. So it almost implied to me a pre-request, but if I'm overreading that and...
consider any, I would say, if you don't want to put the, but the report to us says that it is high risk and that this item has a high financial risk rating, so but we haven't received a risk report. So what I'm asking is that we do get a report of the risk, which has been noted in the report that we have in front of us. And I'm assuming that the committee will need to have information in front of it. I'm struggling to understand what your query is with it.
Well, I think if I can assist, is there an alternate wording that's more useful?
Probably that would be.
Well, we're going to move that, and then we've got a second on this wording.
Which I would be happy.
They may be accepting of a change. So let's try and. Let's get around trouble time.
Yes.
So is there something, if we agree with the principle, is there a better wording?
Thank you.
I still don't understand.
I'm still struggling to understand.
As an officer, I don't know what I've been preparing necessarily.
So I would have thought you would be preparing a report that includes, for example, the PwC report that we've been provided with, that would include the revenue assumptions, that would include potentially the significant assumptions. I'm assuming staff have staff are quite smart and could probably, like they normally do when they're preparing reports for audit, finance and risk, could sit down and work with, if they didn't understand, work with the airport, work with the councillors, potentially work with the independents on the Audit, Finance and Risk Committee to understand. It's difficult to spend too much time here delving into the detail. We've simply asked for a report, so given that you've assigned a high risk rating to it and you've got a risk on the risk register and you've noted that, some detail around it so that we can consider the financial risk. Whatever information the staff believe is necessary to appropriately, fully consider financial risk.
Are we thinking staff create a report, bring it to the committee, and the committee create recommendations for the council in light of long-term plans?
I didn't mean to create additional complexity. All I'm trying to do is make sure that I know what's being asked of us. I think that for me, requesting consideration of is the word that I find difficult, only because I think what you're asking us to do is to report on a financial risk analysis of the QAC's master plan to the Audit, Finance and Risk Committee. That's what you're asking?
Well, I would have assumed our internal risk, because this is our CCO and it's our asset. I am getting to that point. I would have thought that our internal risk processes would naturally have a way to assess. I would have expected a risk report with this. So we have an internal process that is under review at the moment. But if that can't grapple with the financial risk to an asset of a certain level of expenditure over time in the context within which it sits, then we have a problem. So I'm a bit concerned that that's so complicated.
Well, you shouldn't be concerned. I'm just trying to get clarification from you.
So if I can see, the way I see this is the financial risk of the company is for the company's board to assess. Our assessment is the financial risk to do with our LTE.
Yeah,
what I see in this clause here is there's no reference to the LTP. I'd expect our AFRC, instead of assessing the risk of the QAC master plan, I would expect the AFRC to
assess the risk to our LTP.
Yeah. But so thankfully, Your Worship, we won't be in a position to give the full context.
Yes, I know. That's we're not far enough into our LTP to fully assess.
It is. So
as an exercise we can do, I understand the general direction. I just want to be really clear for myself, that's all.
I'm looking at it, as you say, I'm looking at our long-term plan and our assumptions around dividends, which are necessary, obviously, and we thank you for the high dividends, and we've assumed they will continue so far in our planning process, and to also to the shareholder. So those two things are, to me, the financial risks associated with QAC's master plan. I haven't been specific because to do so would potentially cut out some issues that we may need to look at. Largely I'm concerned with risk to the shareholding and risks to our dividends in terms of how that impacts the long-term plan.
So I would be happier if it would give me clarity. Instead of the words requesting consideration of, it would be on.
Yeah, agreed. Take out requesting consideration, and even almost take out and any recommendation to council around it.
I think we need that's the whole point of it, is any recommendations, which doesn't mean that they have to make recommendations. It just means that there is the option there, which is there anyway in the terms of reference, but it makes it clear what we're
expecting. So, Chief Executive, is saying direct staff to prepare a report. We would finance risk committee's meeting on Tuesday, 12th of December, on the financial
risk.
Yeah, okay. That to me gives me a lot more direction.
That's fine.
You've got that
option. We've got a mover and
seconder. Cody to agree. Are you happy with that?
I'm happy with that. Thank you.
Happy with that? Thank you.
Everyone, yes, okay. Absolutely.
So the clause is before you, councillors. This is an amendment to the original motion. All those in favour?
Aye.
All right. All those against? Righto. Motion carried. Now back to the substantive motion. Before we put it to the vote, are you happy? I just noticed that you voted against the amendment prior, so then you're the seconder of the original motion. So I just want to put it to you, are you still happy to be the seconder of the original motion?
Cool.
Thank you, Barry. So we go now to 1, 2, and 3. All those in favour? All right. All those against? Again. Motion carried. Okay. Draft item two, parking strategy for consultation. Thank you, Megan, sorry. Thank you, and thank you to the airport as well. Draft parking strategy for consultation, page 37.
Welcome, Tony. Welcome, Andrew. How are you, Tony?
Lovely.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. We've come to you today with the draft parking strategy to the council, which has been a long time in its gestation. I'll take the report as read, but Andrew and Tony are here for any particular questions.
Questions, councillors?
Thank you. Look, I'm aware of the background of this that's coming up through a number of channels, partly the MPS, partly the, mode shift, it's been driven by a bunch of different reasons. My concern is that it doesn't provide much that's unique to our district, and therefore will be difficult to, for the community to really provide meaningful feedback. I mean, I do fear if we change, did a search and replace for almost any district in the country, it probably still, those principles would still apply. They're quite sound principles, but they're, they are very high level. And I'm aware that this will result in parking management plans and things like that that are the detail, but I'm just wondering what sort of is it specific enough, and what sort of feedback are you think you're likely to get, given that it's not specific enough?
Through the chair, I agree that it's from a high level it does look quite generic, and I guess the devil's going to be in the detail, and particularly sort of in the description of our objectives and the principles rather than them themselves. And I did have a little bit of an issue with that when I first looked at it. But when you think of our district, we cover a lot of different parking-related issues. Whether we're looking at Wanorki, looking at Awea, compared to looking at Queenstown and Wanaka as major town centres. And you're trying to get specific, you start going, well, but in this example, that doesn't apply. And it sort of is tricky from that way. But having said that, I'm happy to look at the final version of this and see whether we can, particularly on the feedback, whether we can get more specific on those as well.
Well, I suppose what I'm wondering is this going to be... Is there value in consulting on this now, or can we consult on it when we go out with our parking management plans or our guidelines, for instance? And I'm just conscious of, you know, the example in Auckland this week where they've actually going out with a specific idea around congestion charges, for instance. You know, that's the stuff that our community will be interested in, is the price-related policy, the timing, the... You know, are you going to use park and rides? Are you, you know, how does public transport and travel demand management play against each other? You know, that's the stuff we need to be talking with our community about. So I'm just concerned. Well, look, this is, as I said, it's not wrong. It's not useful. I just don't see much benefit in talking with our community about it until we've got some real ideas to present to them.
Through the chair, it's why we actually we're starting our stakeholder consultation at the same time as doing this, because we're well aware that strategies people can glaze over and want to get into the detail about their own problems. And so for the first three, the Queenstown, Frankton and Wanaka ones, we're going to start our stakeholder consultation and even community consultation during the consultation on this, so they can both be talked about at the same time and in context as well.
Thanks for that. I totally agree with Quentin on this one, and I'm now even more confused about it. I don't understand what the stakeholder consultation will do, but you can answer that in a moment. But just generally, you know, that's what I keep bringing this up. We keep putting these strategies together, and no disrespect, there's a lot of, dare I say, fluff in here, and we put all this out to the community, and like Quentin said, what are we expecting to come back on it? And if you, for example, and I talked to you briefly outside, if you look at the next on the agenda, the Wilding Pine one on page 77 and page 110, they've got one page of a table which outlines their elements, what success looks like, how we will advise and measure it, all on one page. So if you want the community to get engaged and do it, you've got to give them something. They don't have to read 20 pages of quite repetitive information to get them to focus and give us some response. And so when you say you're going to go to the Wanaka community stakeholders, are we consulting then on the strategy and on a management plan? Or I just want to understand what the second thing you just mentioned was. So generally, I think, you know, we've got so many of these strategies that come like this that you kind of get to the grunt right up front. If you look at the Floating Pine one, it's a very big document, but up that first page, you can see on one page what they're trying to achieve and what we want the community to respond with.
To the chair, we'll definitely be providing a summary during the consultation to do exactly that, because you have to just acknowledge that it is quite long and with a lot of words. We're also establishing stakeholder meetings to go out and we'll talk about the strategy and get their feedback and sort of those overarching ideas that we've got, but also to go out there and say, okay, what are your problems? in these areas, and we can then talk about it in the context of the strategy and get a feel for, is the strategy going the right way at the same time as talking about these. We'll then develop the plans, and then we'll go out to consultation on those plans and give them something solid to consider. So it's this. It's kind of, it is a little bit unfortunate, sort of the way it sort of, we have to structure this and having a strategy and then having the plans, but we need that direction for developing the plans. Otherwise, the plans themselves could go off in their own directions. So, and then we've got to sort of try and come up with a strategy.
So that's a broader question then, and this might be for Mike, because as a strategy at this level, does it require consultation under our significance and engagement policy, or can it actually just be council go, yeah, this is, we're satisfied with this, this is the strategy, now go away and build the detail?
Well, I think there's flexibility for council now to do that. I mean, I think good practice would suggest that we should, you know, adopt a sort of two-stage process, but I think, you know, we should, you know, we should manage that process that's relative to the importance of it, because I think what we've heard is, you know, overall that it's probably, I'm trying to find the right word, vanilla.
What I'm trying to work out, are there any principles in here that we haven't previously socialised and discussed with our community? Because we have done mode shift, we have done, you know,
emissions reduction,
we've done town centre master plans, we've done, you know, all the principles are well in play. In fact, we've done, even more recently, we've done reports on pricing of car parking, which is related, you know. So, I mean, there's nothing in here that we haven't previously socialised.
In some ways, that's right.
Yeah. Yeah.
Just on that, Deputy Mayor, it's just, if I go to paragraph 29, page 42.
Page 42 of our report.
Yes. Yeah. You go to 29, paragraph 29, I think you see that the matter is of high significance as determined by Council's significant engagement policy.
Okay.
And then, but then, paraphrase, this includes but not limited to potentially limiting access to parking to specific users, affecting parking fees and transport projects funded by these fees, or supporting the moving of parking to allow for other road users.
Well, but clearly we would consult on the parking management plan.
Yeah, but this one, this sets the direction on that, so I think it would be wise for us to actually consult on those sorts of issues.
I also think that while we may have made a whole lot of various statements around some of these principles, at least it's consolidated into a document that we've actually consulted on, we potentially are exposed when we start to apply those principles to parking plans that rely on that as policy guidance and what your intent is, unless we've been through that process. But I've noted in the report, paragraph 26 in the table, it's on 41, that sort of outlines the proposed consultation process. So November, January, parking strategy, and then, as Andrew said, talk in those individual areas around the workshops on the respective parking management plans, and looking through that, then adopting the strategy, and then coming back and finishing those parking management plans. But sitting here, I'd be concerned at the possibility of not consulting on that strategy, and then finding ourselves being unpicked at some future date because we don't have a consulted on council policy and strategy around these principles.
Well, we don't have this one, we've got multiple ones. As I've said, I don't think there's anything, but anyway.
Thank you. So a couple of questions. I understand that, and I appreciate having the principles first and consulting on them. On the other hand, it's only when you dig into the detail sometimes that people go, oh yeah, that matters too. And I'm worried that if we cement the principles, that when something unique comes up, that sort of runs counter to some of these, that it might limit the, you know, the outcomes from community consultation. So what would your thoughts be on that?
Yeah, through the chair, I agree with that, and that's the benefit of actually going out through this stakeholder consultation, is that we actually get to hear about the issues that are on the ground and just make sure that what they're what they're talking about as issues still fit the context that we're also talking about in strategy. I mean, a lot of strategies go through before actually any plans, and that's where stakeholder engagement happens. So
I guess what I mean is that people like to consult on the detail, and they're more likely to engage on that and really think. This is just a bunch of words.
I think it's worse than that. They're crying out for it. I mean, we know that Wanaka particularly is crying out for some meaningful discussion around how we're going to manage parking in the town centre. You know, and I'd rather have that discussion, quite frankly, than anyway. That's
I think we can take that on board. I mean, I think while Councillor Benning raises a risk of perhaps working with principles, the other risk is probably greater, that if you don't have some principles, then you don't have a way of actually consolidating or organising. So I think what we need to do is establish those principles, but actually always be aware that through the details, it's not wrong to depart from principles as long as you're very clear about why you're doing that.
Yeah,
and to me, I think the parking management plans allow us to look at the uniqueness of that and say, yep, we've got some overriding principles, this is the direction, but in these circumstances, there is some rationale for moving from that. We don't want to be bound.
Yeah.
That's wrong. We want to have principles, but we don't want to be necessarily shackled by them.
Yeah, so we want to allow for flexibility, and that can be something that's submitted on, obviously. There were a couple of gaps that I thought. I didn't see anything around car sharing and the infrastructure around that, like loading zones and drop-off points and things. So, the other one would have been around private coaches and whether there's some tension there between limiting buses but wanting to get the tourists onto coaches potentially, and so I think there are some improvements that could be made to it that are worth going out and for consultation. There are a couple of things, just wording that I think is slightly misleading if you don't take the care to read it fully in its context. I'm on page 63, was that?
63 of the
agenda? No, page 63 and 17 of the document. And it says supporting the reallocation of parking to public space to enhance the place function and quality around our town centres, which could be read as from private space to public space. It says reallocation, so it's actually the removal of parking from public space. So I just think, and there's another one, where the context is kind of assumed.
Sorry,
and
is this one? Are you suggesting that? I'm still trying to find it.
1.1.
It's
1.1.5.
Last bullet point.
Page 63. So it's when you read it, it's hard with my notes because they're a bit
But
in terms of, so it says supporting the reallocation of parking to public space to enhance place function and quality around our town centres. So are we supporting reallocation of parking to public space from private space, or are we supporting the reallocation of parking from public space to allow pedestrians? I just think that was weirdly worded, and given we're consulting, it might pay to make it really clear. And the other one was 1.1.2, which says introducing paid parking in new areas, which sounds like we could be expanding parking, and some people might be going, yay, but actually we're converting free parking to paid parking, I think, from the context.
Just to be clear, these are general principles. That doesn't mean to say that in every place there is free parking.
No, but we're consulting on the principles, so I just want it, when people read through it, I don't want them to work too hard at having to read what's around it to get the meaning of things, and don't want them to make assumptions. So just have a gloss over it. I'm not suggesting any changes right now. I'm just, if we read it, just making sure that we're not, as parking people, making assumptions about what things mean.
Could you just remind me which is the bullet point of the 1.1.2 you highlighted?
Oh, sorry, introducing paid parking in new areas?
Yeah, I've got that. Thank you.
Thanks.
Is it possible to do a joint consultation? So have the strategy and plans together? Because I feel like that we talk about consultation fatigue, that people, you know, we're just going out all the time, and this would be the same thing twice in a year. Talking about getting meaningful, what are the disadvantages of doing that? Because I do see some advantages of doing that in terms of
kind of hitting people once with it. If we're saying we have got some flexibility around the strategy, then if we just went at once saying, and maybe that's after the workshops with your key stakeholders, but in terms of a cost thing as well, what would be the disadvantages of that?
Through the chair, I guess in this case we aren't actually doing plans for everyone, so we need, this is a district-wide strategy, so we need to have that consultation across the district, and then we're looking at the specific plans for Queenstown Town Centre, Wanaka Town Centre and Frankton. It is thematic, and I mean, from my perspective, I guess we could do anything here. I could go out and consult at the same time with the plans as well. And it still would work because we're still working within that context of the strategy as well, and to make sure that they both work at the same time. But yeah, certainly with the, given that that there are other areas that aren't being involved in those plans, so we're going to give them a chance to comment as well.
Do you have with that now?
Just on. Hang on. Oh, sorry.
Barry, and then I'll go back. Thanks. So, through the chair, of course, part of this is consulting with key stakeholder groups. What constitutes a stakeholder group for this role, and how do you identify those groups?
For the chair, we're identifying groups that organisations that represent a whole lot of people rather than going to individual organisations. That's principally what we're trying to distinguish between in terms of stakeholders. Where there are stakeholders that aren't represented, then we're going out to talk to individual ones as well. Plus anyone that comes through in the consultation that we think we need to talk to, we'll also talk to individually as well. We've already started doing that. We've already had a few companies come to us and say we've got issues, and we've already talked to them to try and give some direction to the strategy and the guidelines we're currently working on at the moment as well. It is a wide group that we're looking at.
Thank you, through the chair. I'm not sure I need to really ask the question now, but I guess with regards to what Mel was saying, and it would mean redoing everything, but you know how you've obviously got this structure. So could we not just preface each management plan with the strategy? So actually, the strategic direction for the whole district prefaces like the management plan of Queenstown, Frankton, Wanaka, and
One would assume that would as a principle once you've
established. I don't mean sequentially, I mean actually as a document, the parking strategy actually goes into each of these documents.
I think the risk that you're running though is that you're saying we're supposed, because we would build, all things being equal, without actually consulting and working, we would accept that this is our position, this is what we're going to do, and we would use that to design the parking management plans. I think what we're trying to say is that actually we go through this exercise with the community. We don't really understand how much engagement will happen. Some people have suggested not a lot. But that then, once we've got that, that gives us a much sounder basis for then developing the individual parking management plans. So making that assumption now, writing those parking management plans now on the basis of something that's not been tested with the community, to me suggests that we've already agreed that this is what we're going to do.
Okay. So just on that then, my only comment really is I think the time frame that you've got is good because you've extended that period of consultation. But I just do think that it's just an incredibly heavy document and it could be wordsmithed a bit to reduce it down.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Two quick questions. One, this might come in around stakeholders in this strategy. Where do we start to address, a lot of this talks about our control of trying to drive people out of their cars. Cars and car parking will always be a part of our transportation picture. Where are we identifying the stars, the lone eagles, if you like, that we might be able to JV or PPP with around innovative parking solutions, putting actual parking buildings, I don't know, underground again. We look at the visionaries of our past, people like John Martin, may he rest in peace, that established some of our infrastructure around parking. I don't get a vision of where they're coming from in the future. Are we going to build a building that stacks cars on top of each other? Are we going to go underground in a spiral? So that's my first question. How do we identify stakeholders that can partner with us to create parking solutions? And my second question, just so I get them all out there, your parking plans, I know you've got other parking management plans. I'm here with my Arrowtown add-on. We've got 1,200 employees in Arrowtown. We've identified that Lakehays Estate is our dormitory suburb for our Arrowtown workforce. They need cars. There's no PT connection between those. There's no bus route between Lakehays and Arrowtown. Same with the parking inequity with our communities like Glenrothes that aren't serviced by actual PT. How are we going to accommodate the people that do need to have their cars in these communities? You can tell me where that fits into the strategy. Here we go.
Right. Through the chair, it actually is a very good point around talking to stakeholders who could partner with us around parking solutions. Certainly we'll include that and look into that. Around Lake Hayes, it's our number one is around, or our top, I guess, objective is to prioritise around according to user needs. And we know that there, and I guess in some respects this is why it's so generic, is we know there's a lot of different user needs. And Arrowtown, as you say, you're serviced by an area that doesn't have good other options. So those are the sort of needs that we'll be looking at when we do each of the plans. And if there's a need for parking because there's no other options, then that's what we'll have to look at for Arrowtown. But at the same time, it's actually quite beneficial that we're doing this strategy at the same time as the public transport business case is being worked on. And sort of that sort of feedback can go into the public transport business case. And so we can look at providing better public transport connections.
Which again might look back to everybody else's comments about the consultation. Yeah. Are we getting these synergies between the different pieces to come together?
Oh, we're definitely working through that and through the Way to Go group, obviously.
If I may respond a little bit better, this is only one aspect of the wider transport program. The parking management could sit under the travel demand management, how we approach the wider behavioural change across the whole network. They do sit hand in hand, but this is a discrete piece, as is the public transport business case we're doing. So in terms of where the innovation would come from, well, that further consultation with stakeholders might be through the travel demand management piece of work and setting up our travel management associations. It may be that we work with the local commerce or local businesses to find new innovative solutions to it. This is more of a focusing on just the parking management aspect, and there are other aspects that we will address, and we're also now into parallel pieces of work which aren't yet before you as a council.
Thank you. I think this, thank you again through the chair, it's that piece of, you know, I look at other communities where they might have a really high congestion charge or parking charge to come into the centre, but they are providing somewhere for those people to park and a method to connect and network them in. I'm concerned that we just come at it from a regulatory piece without providing that other strategic piece around what's our balance. We can't just say we're going to hit you harder if we're not providing an offline method for you to get here, a ferry or a wash or a bus or a what have you. We can't say to our workforces, you can't bring your car in,
and we don't offer a bus home after 10 o'clock at night. It just doesn't work. So how else are we going to accommodate? And that's the bit, 100% let's get everyone out of their cars, but the ones that need their cars, we're going to put them. So thank you.
Tony said, as Chairman, I mean, a bit of work being done as well. This is one part of those options. We're working with passenger transport. This is one part of it. And I don't think this is about saying just putting in regulatory controls to keep cars out of areas. It's far more complicated than that. But it is one bit of the puzzle, I suppose, and it is about having some principles. And so I think we get to the parking plans, the needs of the likes of our town versus located users. We'll be aware that more area-specific issues will need to be considered in terms of who's parking, the nature of that, those sorts of things.
Through the Chair, on that as well, it's something we've certainly considered, and through the guidelines and the plans, what we're looking at is having triggers. So, say, until public transport goes in, then this is the way we'll manage the parking. Once public transport starts happening, then these are the other things we can start doing to the parking. So making sure that there is that sort of step wise changes that are occurring rather than just going straight to any restrictions as such.
Okay, so I hope you're from Lyle, Matt, Cody, or Bird, if you
are.
I'm happy. Let's go to Lyle.
Oh, just a real quick one, this one you said, Tony, maybe just sort of say a little chart of all the activities and where this fits in, just so people know that, you know, they don't explain to me every time, oh, we're doing a public transport strategy to do that. So just a simple chart to show you what's all the things that are happening and how this feeds into it.
Okay.
Now
we'll move on to discussion now. Well, before you ask questions.
I know, yeah. I forgot. Can I do one more? It's just
we'll
the
move
timing.
On. I think we've thrashed the questions in.
Real
important one.
I can bring it up, but there's approval
in. Right, so we've got recommended motion before us, councillors. So I have a member. Thank you, Matt. We have a seconder. Thank you, Barry. Discussion?
Yep. It's just around the timing. So I didn't get the sense when I was reading it. It was all about mode shift and great. But what I... When we did this, obviously we removed private parking, the government removed private parking, and part of doing this was supposed to be that we're signalling to the market what's going to happen so that the market then decides, do I want to put in parking or do I not want to, in terms of a hotel being built or somebody building their private house, because we can't require it. So these rules would signal and then decisions would be made about what the best thing was, whether to do parking or not. There's sort of no sense that that's one of the purposes of this, and I think it's filtered into the timing and the staging, because to me, somewhere like Hawea, where there's significant growth, where that could happen and where there's, you know, there's no parking buildings or anything, you can, or even in GY, which is unlikely now, right, because of our adaptation piece, but one hotel can have a massive impact, and if it decides that there's plenty of space and there's no yellow lines and there's no, you know, so why are we not considering the staging of, you know, the plans and making sure that we do them in time to direct the private market in terms of whether it supplies on-site parking or not.
Okay, so
sorry, that was discussion.
Yeah, but discussion. Thanks.
Just going back to the stakeholders and consultation. Is there a possibility that the elected members could have some input into guiding the process in terms of who the stakeholder groups are? Because we talk about parking in general terms, but more and more often in the Wanaka Community Board public forum situations, we're getting representations from groups who have mobility limitations and feeling a wee bit isolated and cut off with lack of access, and I think it's very, very important to spread that consultation net as wide as possible. And I think the likes of the community board will be able to give some guidance as to who those groups are and give them opportunity to voice their concerns.
That's a good point. Just before we go to the vote, just want to thank you, Andrew. I know this has been a long process. I think back to when I was chair of the Franklin Community Association, I think we were talking about this in 2015, 2016. So I appreciate it's been a long process to get here. And I appreciate some of the concerns raised by councillors regarding whether we tie things up. But when I look back at some of the actions were taken in Franklin, in my own neighbourhood, if we'd had some of those policies and strategies in place, I think it would have been a lot more palatable and a lot more understanding, especially in some of the streets that we put that 48-hour restriction notice in. So I appreciate the work. We've got a mover and a seconder. Mover and a seconder. I'm going to open it up to the mover if they've got the right to reply, or I'll put it to the vote.
Okay.
We don't have to.
Oh, no, I do want to say something, actually.
Yep.
What I'd love to see, actually, is some real good imagery and potentially when we talk about mode shift, some really good imagery about what businesses potentially could be providing in terms of parking for micro-mobility motorcycles, for example. It actually moves us away from thinking about car parks completely. And I know that's further down the planning stage, but that's what I want to see, some real good vision of what our parking could look like without cars.
Thank you, Matt. Okay, so we have a mover and a seconder with the motion in front of us. All those in favour?
Aye.
Aye.
All those against? Motion carried. Thank you.
Thank you.
Councillors, before we move to the next item, we'll just have a 5-minute break.
Yep, please. Thank you.
Thank you. Yes. 168 council papers, Wakatipu Wilding, Conifer Strategy 2023-2033.
Ken, you. Oh, who is it?
Thank you,
Chair. Kia ora koutou, Yvette Ridley Park's team. Report taken as read. Happy to answer any questions.
Questions, councillors?
I'm happy to move this one on if appropriate, but it's...
we've got to move that. I'll let you finish.
Great work, Wellington Vines, crack on. Can't wait for Wanaka to get its share as well, including the ones that sit on Mount Iron in front of my house. I know that they're doing parallel work over there, but I'm very happy to support and move.
Can you give me Mayor and Matt as a seconder? Any further discussion?
I'm so sorry.
Go for it.
So I happen to be lucky enough to be the rep, and I often miss the meetings, unfortunately, because they're on Thursday morning, but I just got huge, huge faith in the group from watching what goes on in there and the way money is spent, and I just wanted to say that it's such a pleasure to see a strategy document drawn up by a group that doesn't cost a fortune, a group that has expertise in the area and that is doing the work for us a lot cheaper than we could do it if it was, you know, left with us. So once upon a time I was wondering about, you know, Wilding Pines, you know, given the helicopters, and they do such amazing work. So that's first thing I want to say. Second thing I want to say was just around council's involvement and advocacy for funding for this, because you know, obviously there has been a lot of funding recently, and there's a sense that that has dried up, and that we're at risk of letting things go again. And if we're wasting everything that has gone before, do you think there's any more we can? Well, I'm sure there is always more we can do, but what more do you think we could do to advocate to central government on this issue for funding for wilding pine removal?
I know ORC commissioned a cost-benefit analysis, which just was made public in the council meeting last week. So Ministry of Primary Industries had one last year, which said it was 34-1 for New Zealand. The one that ORC got from Boffa Miskell says that it's 96-1. so are much higher, and they are planning on using that report to then try and leverage more money from national government.
It would be great. I would just signal that I'm really supportive of us doing, if we've got any space and time and capacity, looking at how we could support and really drive getting some funding from Central for this. Okay. Thank you.
Good question. You mentioned ORC, other stakeholders. Do you take this to their, do this get endorsed at one of their ORC meetings, or does it not have to be? Do you get a formal endorsement from some of your other partners, not just QLDC?
For the strategy, I believe. Yeah, the ORC was involved in the development of the strategy, as was QLDC. This strategy aligns with the ORC strategy. So they perfectly align, and I guess that we don't so much have one, which is hence why we're tabling this today.
Just through you, Chair, Councillor, one of the aspects too, you'll know that key stakeholders or partners actually including the Department of Conservation, some of the other government land owners, as well as the way that we position this with some of our key contractors. But as Yvette's rightly pointed out, this is actually quite unique, and one of the things to reflect upon that the Deputy Mayor's touched on is that we are only one of the few districts, if not the only district, outside of a regional province or regional council setting that actually is involved in this national component of where we take this program. So, you know, we've actually set the trend. We're very fortunate with the track record. The level of investment has given some surety, but it's certainly, as you heard from Mr. Hensman today, and what Yvette's outlined, there's been a lot of focus around the way that we've gone about establishing and delivering on this program.
Yeah, well, what I was leading to was if we had some sort of formal endorsement, especially from DOC or ORC, it gets back to the question, you know, we'd go to DOC and say, hey, DOC, you've actually, or the government, should I say, one of your departments has endorsed this strategy, we need the readies to get on with it. You know what I'm getting at? So you know, we're doing a formal process, and we've only got they could do some more formal type process that we could actually refer to.
Okay, thank you, councillors. We have a mover and deputy mayor and seconder and Matt. All those in favour?
Aye.
All those against? None. Motion carried.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Item 4 is an independent hearing panel recommendation, proposed plan change 54, North Lake Drive plan change. Page 114 of your papers. Jeffrey, is that? Yep. And Ellie, away we go.
Kelvin. I'll take the report and appendices as read, but before going to questions, I'll just provide a quick recap. So this agenda item relates to a private plan change to the North Lake Special Zone, which is part of the operative district plan. It's to provide road into the neighbouring Sticky Forest, which is currently landlocked, and to amend the structure plan policies and rules to provide for an additional activity area. This plan change has gone through the Schedule 1 process, and in July the independent hearing panel heard submissions on that plan change and identified a few issues and provided recommendations on those. So some of those issues included transportation, landscape, stormwater. So what we're seeking from this agenda item is for the council to accept the plan change, or accept the recommendations report of that independent hearing panel. I'll open to questions there.
Questions, councillors? No questions. Got a recommended motion before us. Do I have a mover? Barry, seconder. Thank you, Lyle. Discussion?
I've just got a brief comment that I don't intend to support this, and I do it unknowingly, and that on the basis that I cannot accept the advice regarding the adequacy of the transport infrastructure. And yeah, that's my only comment.
Thank you. Mover and a seconder, all those in favour?
Aye.
All those against? Motion carried. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Item 5, adoption of the QLDC Cemeteries Bylaw 2023, page 120, Council of Papers. Ken, is it?
That's all I was
Ken. How do these parties come? Don't see watching online, so you should be up.
She's probably thinking, oh, they're taking ages. Yeah. I'm all vivid for this one.
She's had the lights that weren't working. Happy to crack on, Mum.
Yes, crack on. Yeah.
Thank you, Chair. Yeah.
Cool. I think there's Niall walking down. Go for it, Ken.
Thank you, Chair. As you will know, officers have been working on the updated aspects associated with the cemetery bylaw for the district. Take it that the report has been read, and if there's any questions, happy to take those.
Questions, councillors?
Thank you. Thank you, Ken. I suppose it's a community question that arose actually last week, Ken. I spent Sunday with the RSA and the Far East in Arrowtown cleaning and fixing some ceramic poppies to our returned servicemen's monuments, and it raised discussion around the type of maintenance and work that can be carried out in cemeteries and who's responsible and able to do that kind of work. And you know, we noted that many of the families are taking it into their own hands to recondition some of our older sites. Some of the founding fathers, where there really isn't perhaps remaining family, and I'm just seeking some clarity for our community as to we witness things like blackberry growing through masonry where it's been cut back but at risk of damaging ancient wall structures or whatever they might be. So maybe for our community, if you could just speak to that, how that sits between our different council obligations and our community groups that have got strong interests in these areas.
Through you, Chair. Thank you, Councillor. I'll set the scene and then pop past to my colleague. So in regards to the actual ongoing maintenance of some of these sites, and it's good to learn of what you've done with the RSA and other members like that, what we tend to find is some of the groups are quite coordinated, particularly around the old diggers, in respect to those leading up to, you know, armistice or Remembrance Day. Certainly Anzac Day is obviously a big trigger for our communities. And actually it's been quite good to see, I guess, the refreshed aspect of youth and others starting to get back into that space where some of those in the past are no longer able to undertake those works. The wider maintenance of sites for the general purposes across all our districts does sit with the plot holder. And we are certainly acutely aware of that ongoing maintenance. It's not an aspect we actually have within our levels of service that we can commit across the 10 operational and historic sites. However, where, and this is where I'll be handing over to my colleague, where we have had opportunities to do some of the community cleaning or working bees and other aspects, we have certainly been able to undertake that with that duty of care around how we can keep the presentation of our cemeteries to a high standard. And I must say, if you do visit other districts, we actually do that very well across a wide network. But we can't always get down to the personalised outcomes of dealing with some of the gorse or broom on a per plot basis.
Thank you. Just perhaps one little clarifying bit on that through the chair, if I may. So the question specifically, and this might just be a distinction as to where they'll sit, they may sit within the cemetery's handbook. But like our fire team was saying, are they enabled to go in and spray, for example, or is that not appropriate as far as tikanga and things within an Urapa situation? Are they allowed to have vehicles in and around their moving gardening tools around, or is that something that would be discouraged under that bylaw? So any of those sorts of...
Yeah.
Yeah, good question. In terms of spraying, that's generally not undertaken in a cemetery. It's a sensitivity issue, particularly for plot holders. Some don't have a problem with it, but because some do, it's better that we just defer to not spraying. So we use other methods, for instance, cutting and pasting and things like that, when it comes to that kind of maintenance care. The question about vehicles, maintenance vehicles are allowed to be able to access other areas of the cemetery. So that opportunity is still available despite the bylaw because we are able to give them an exception. It's usually those people who are contracted to undertake works and therefore aware of kind of the risks and requirements of operating within a cemetery. So there are actually some people that can come in and get close and do that type of work. For instance, masons who come in to do all the headstones. Yeah, they could do that.
And then just through you, Chair, just adding to, we're really sensitive. We often deal with people that want to visit that might be elderly, mobility is an issue. You know, so through the care of the team, we certainly do tailor that response. But we are really mindful of making sure we don't end up with car parkings across the sites.
Thank you.
So I'll just raise the point. I mean, obviously, what we're dealing with today is the adoption of the bylaws. I think thanks to those comments, and Lisa, obviously, if the groups want to follow up and specifically look at things, then obviously TASC is the right point of contact for that going forward.
Just remind me, who was on the panel?
Thank you.
Any further questions, councillors? Okay, do we have a mover? EQ, Lise. Sorry. Mel and Esther second. Sorry. Any discussion? Okay, all those in favour?
Aye.
All against? Motion carried.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thanks, Ken.
Item 6,
which is the submission on lowering the voting
age. Julie sees submission on electoral lowering the voting age for local elections and polls legislation bills. Erin and Harris.
Yes, thank you. I'll take the report as read and I'm happy to answer any questions.
Questions, councillors? None at all? No questions?
I just can't recall where. I know I must have missed it. Copy here on this one.
That's right.
That's all right.
Thanks for your contribution.
You're too old to vote on that anyway.
Thank you, through the chair. So these would come into effect in 2028, is that correct?
Yes.
For the perennial local elections?
Yes.
That was really my only question. Thank you.
Children will be 12 now.
Yeah.
You're counting, aren't you?
You gotta work out who you're polling to.
Wow. Well, I guess the reason that I'm actually interested, but it doesn't really require discussion, is because I was just thinking about the civics education and the lead up to that. With regards to what we could do as an organisation, but I don't feel that we'll probably that need to have that discussion now. So, yeah.
Okay, we've got recommended motions before us. Way of a mover. Thank you, Katie, seconder. Thank you, Nikki. Any discussion?
Oh, just that my view is that, and I still can't understand why that we're separating, why the government's way they're going about this, between national elections and local body elections, and such a time delay on it. I just think it's all out of kilter.
I agree.
Probably just a comment around the civics education piece and acknowledging that our age bracket and enrolment rate is showing that our young people in the district are more engaged and aware of democracy. Met with the Wapitipa Youth Trust yesterday, and they're looking to re-establish their youth council. I've got a new member on their team who will be championing that for us, so being quite proactive around bringing that back to the table.
and also spoke to the new principal at Arrowtown Primary around the desire for some of our Year 8 students to be representative in the community associations, that might also be a cohort to approach through our Year 7, 8 cohorts to just start peppering this civic awareness back out to our community. So really back that up, and I do see our young people as being very engaged. That was shown in our mayoral debate in the campaign trail as to some of the great questions they put to our candidates. So I think it's really exciting to see us embrace opportunities for our youth to be more engaged in democracy. I'm really looking forward to it.
So, further discussion? All those in favour?
Aye.
Aye.
Against? Motion carried.
We should have an upper limit.
Thank you. Chief Executive's report, page 163, item 7.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. So, only one item to agree. Councillors?
Councillors?
Thank you. Where are you going, Chief? Only one item, which is actually agreeing the notice of intention to publish the reserve management plan, and then you'll see in the body of the report just noting the key items of topics that went to the current and latest round of committee meetings. So, a very simple report this month. Your Worship?
Questions? No. You may move it. We have a seconder. Thank you. Discussion? No. All those in favour?
Aye.
Those against? None. Motion carried. Thank you. I move that we move to public exclusion. Thank you, Barry. All those in favour?
Aye.
Those against?